everyone. This is Dr. Adel Bandak, Professor of Anatomy and Neuroscience, Mansoura University, Egypt. Today I will talk about the skeleton of the upper limb. I will talk about the anatomical features of each bone, and in another lecture I will talk about the muscle attachment and some clinical notes. Regarding the skeleton, okay, first we'll talk about the regions. This is the first region, which is called the shoulder girdle. Shoulder girdle is formed of two bones, the clavicle anterior and the scapula posterior. Then the arm, and the skeleton of the arm is the humerus. Then the skeleton of the forearm. The forearm has two bones. The radius is the lateral bone. The ulna is the medial bone. Then skeleton of the hand. Skeleton of the hand is divided into three parts: carpal bones, metacarpal bones, and phalanges. Start by the shoulder girdle. Shoulder girdle, clavicle anterior, and scapula posterior. Start by, okay, so clavicle anterior and scapula posterior. Start by the clavicle. This is the clavicle. The clavicle is a long bone, and being a long bone, it is formed of two ends and the shaft. The two ends, medial end and the lateral end. The medial end is called sternal end because it articulates with the sternum. The lateral end is called acromial end because it articulates with the acromion. The medial end is large. The lateral end is flattened. Then the shaft. The shaft is divided into medial 2/3 and the lateral 1/3. Okay, the medial 2/3 are convex anterior. The lateral 1/3 is convex posterior. And actually, this side, okay, the junction between the medial 2/3 and the lateral 1/3 is the site of fracture of the clavicle. The shaft has four surfaces: upper surface, inferior surface, anterior, and posterior. Again, this is the clavicle. The clavicle has two ends, medial end and the lateral end. This is the medial end. It's called the sternal end. It is larger than the lateral end. It articulates with the sternum. It articulates with the manubrium of the sternum to form the sternoclavicular joint. This is the sternoclavicular joint, which is a synovial saddle joint. Okay? The lateral end is flattened. It articulates with the acromion of the scapula to form the acromioclavicular joint. This acromioclavicular joint is plain synovial joint. Then the shaft. The shaft has four surfaces: anterior, posterior, superior, and inferior. Okay? And the shaft is divided into medial 2/3 and the lateral 1/3. The medial 2/3 are convex anterior. The lateral 1/3 is convex posterior. And the clavicle is the most fractured bone, and the fracture is usually at the junction between the medial 2/3 and the lateral 1/3. Four surfaces: upper surface, inferior surface, anterior, and posterior. The inferior surface has three features. The medial 1/3 has impression for the costoclavicular ligament. The lateral 1/3 has conoid tubercle and the trapezoid line. Conoid tubercle for conoid ligament, trapezoid line for trapezoid ligament, and the two ligaments form coracoclavicular ligament. The middle 1/3 has groove for the subclavius muscle. What are the functions of the clavicle? The clavicle connects the upper limb to the axial skeleton. So it supports the upper limb. It transmits forces from the upper limb to the axial skeleton. That's why you don't feel the weight of the upper limb. It also gives attachment to muscles. The clavicle differs from other long bones in five features. So what are the five differences between the clavicle and the other long bones? The first one, it lies horizontally. Second one, it has no medullary cavity. It doesn't have medullary cavity. It is the first bone to ossify in the fetal life. It ossifies during the fifth week of intrauterine life. It ossifies in membrane, so membranous ossification, not cartilaginous. And the last one, it is the commonly fractured bone. So what are the five differences between the clavicle and the other long bones? It lies horizontally. It has no medullary cavity. It is the first bone to ossify in the fetal life. It ossifies in membrane. It is the commonly fractured bone. Then the scapula. This is the scapula. The scapula has three angles: lateral, superior, and inferior. It has superior three borders: upper, medial, and lateral. It has three fossae: supraspinous, infraspinous, and subscapular, and the three processes: spine, acromion, and the coracoid process. So the three angles: superior angle, inferior angle, and the lateral angle. The superior angle lies opposite the second rib. The inferior angle lies opposite the seventh rib. The lateral angle is called the head. The head carries three features. Number one, glenoid cavity for the articulation with the head of the humerus to form the shoulder joint. It has supraglenoid tubercle and infraglenoid tubercle. Three borders. Superior border is the shortest. Medial border is called the vertebral border. Lateral border is called the axillary border. The upper border has a notch. This notch is called suprascapular notch. Three fossae. One above the spine, supraspinous fossa. One below the spine, infraspinous fossa. And this one is subscapular fossa. Three processes. Spine, acromion, coracoid process. The posterior border of the spine is called the crest, and the medial end of the crest of the spine lies opposite T3 spine. So this is the spine, and the crest of the spine, it lies opposite T3. The acromion is continuous with the spine, and then the coracoid process. Again, three angles: superior angle, inferior angle, lateral angle. Superior angle is opposite the second rib. Inferior angle is opposite the seventh rib. Lateral angle is called the head. It carries glenoid cavity for the articulation with the head of the humerus. It has supraglenoid tubercle and infraglenoid tubercle. Three borders: upper border, medial border, and lateral border. Medial border is called vertebral because it is parallel to the vertebrae, and lateral border is called the axillary border, and the upper border has notch. This is the suprascapular notch. Three fossae, one above the spine, supraspinous fossa, one below the spine, infraspinous fossa, and this one is the subscapular fossa. Three processes. This is the first one, spine. Okay, this is the suprascapular notch. This is the spine. And the posterior border of the spine is called the crest. And the medial end of the crest is opposite T3 spine. This is the acromion, which is continuous with the spine. And this is the coracoid process. Again, this is the upper superior angle opposite the second rib. This is the inferior angle opposite the seventh rib. This is the lateral angle, which is called the head, has glenoid cavity, infraglenoid tubercle, and the supraglenoid tubercle. This is the suprascapular notch, supraspinous fossa, infraspinous fossa, and the subscapular fossa. Spine, acromion, and the coracoid process. the spine is separated from the glenoid cavity or is separated from the head by this notch, a spinoglenoid notch. Then we'll talk about the bone of the arm, which is the humerus. This is the humerus. The humerus is a long bone. So being a long bone, it is formed of two ends and shaft. This is the upper end, this is the lower end, and this is the shaft. The upper end is formed of head, neck, and two tuberosities. So head, neck, anatomical and surgical, greater tuberosity and lesser tuberosity, and between the two tuberosities, this groove is called bicipital groove, this one. The lower end is formed of articular and non-articular parts. The articular part is formed of trochlea and capitulum. This is the trochlea, this is the capitulum. The non-articular part is formed of two epicondyles, medial epicondyle, lateral epicondyle, and the three fossae. The three fossae, okay, this one is coronoid fossa, this one is the radial fossa, and behind olecranon fossa. It has three borders, anterior border, medial border, lateral border, three surfaces, anteromedial, anterolateral, and the posterior surface. Okay, so again, this is the humerus, upper end, lower end, and the shaft. This is the upper end. Upper end is formed of, the first is the head. Head articulates with the glenoid cavity to form the shoulder joint, which is ball and the socket synovial joint. Then the neck. We have two necks. Okay, this is the anatomical neck, which is constriction beyond the head, and this is the surgical neck, okay, below the two tuberosities. It's called the surgical neck because it is liable to fracture. Then greater tuberosity and lesser tuberosity, and in between bicipital groove. So the upper end, head, anatomical neck, surgical neck, greater tuberosity, lesser tuberosity, bicipital groove. This is the lower end. It's formed of articular part and the non-articular part. The articular part is the trochlea and the capitulum. The non-articular part, medial epicondyle, this is the medial epicondyle, lateral epicondyle, this is the lateral epicondyle, and the three fossae. The three fossae, this is the first one, which is called coronoid fossa, this is the radial fossa, and olecranon fossa. This is the trochlea, which is medial, this is the capitulum, which is lateral, this is the coronoid fossa, this is the radial fossa, and this is the olecranon fossa. So the lower end is formed of articular part and the non-articular part. The articular part, trochlea and capitulum. The trochlea articulates with the trochlear notch of the ulna to form a part of the elbow joint. The capitulum articulates with the head of the radius to form the humeroradial part of the elbow joint. Non-articular part, medial epicondyle, lateral epicondyle. The medial epicondyle is more projecting than the lateral epicondyle. Three fossae, coronoid fossa lodges the coronoid process during flexion. Radial fossa lodges the head of the radius during flexion, and the olecranon fossa lodges the olecranon process of the ulna during extension. Regarding the shaft, this is the posterior surface of the shaft. It has a spiral groove or radial groove. It's called the radial groove because it is related to the radial nerve. And this tuberosity is called deltoid tuberosity because it gives insertion to the deltoid muscle. What is the articulation of the humerus? Upper end and the lower end. The upper end of the humerus, the head of the humerus, articulates with the glenoid cavity to form the shoulder joint, which is ball and the socket synovial joint. Lower end, trochlea and the capitulum. The trochlea articulates with the trochlear notch of the ulna. The capitulum articulates with the upper surface of the head of the radius to form the humeroradial part of the elbow joint. So the elbow joint is formed of humeroulnar part and humeroradial part. The humeroulnar part between the trochlea and the trochlear notch of the ulna, humeroradial part between the capitulum and the upper surface of the head of the radius. Regarding the skeleton of the forearm, the forearm has two bones. The lateral bone is the radius, and the medial bone is the ulna. These two bones are long bones. So being a long bone, each one is formed of upper end, lower end, and shaft. Okay, so again, each one has two ends and shaft, upper end, lower end, and shaft. Okay, start by the ulna. This is the upper end of the ulna. The upper end of the ulna is formed of two notches and two processes. The two notches are trochlear notch and radial notch. This trochlear notch articulates with the trochlea of the humerus to form the elbow joint or to form the humeroulnar part of the elbow joint. This is the radial notch. It articulates with the head of the radius, the circumference of the head of the radius, to form the superior radioulnar joint. Two notches. This is the trochlear notch. Okay, two processes. This is the olecranon process, and this is the coronoid process. Another features, this tuberosity is called ulnar tuberosity in front of the coronoid process. This crest is called the supinator crest below the radial notch in front of the supinator crest, supinator fossa. So what are the features of the upper end of the ulna? Two notches and two processes. The two notches, trochlear notch and radial notch. The two processes, olecranon process and the coronoid process. Other features, supinator crest, supinator fossa, and ulnar tuberosity. This is the lower end of the ulna. The lower end of the ulna is formed of head and the styloid process. Regarding the head of the ulna, this is the head of the ulna. The head of the ulna articulates with the ulnar notch of the radius to form the inferior radioulnar joint. The head of the ulna is separated from the carpal bones by this articular disc. So the head of the ulna is separated from the carpal bones by the articular disc. Therefore, the ulna doesn't take part in the formation of the wrist joint. So the lower end of the ulna, head, and the styloid process. The head of the ulna articulates with the ulnar notch of the radius to form inferior radioulnar joint. The head of the ulna is separated from the carpal bones by articular disc. That's why it doesn't take part in the formation of the wrist joint. Regarding the radius, this is the radius. It is formed of upper end, lower end, and shaft. Regarding the upper end, it is formed of three parts, head, neck, and radial tuberosity. Regarding the head, the head of the ulna actually take part in the formation of two joints. The upper surface articulates with the capitulum of the humerus to form elbow joint. The circumference articulates with the radial notch of the ulna. This is the radial notch of the ulna to form superior radioulnar joint. So the head of the ulna takes part in the formation of the elbow joint and the superior radioulnar joint. This is the superior radioulnar joint. Regarding the neck, this is the constriction below the head. This neck is surrounded by this ligament. This ligament is called the annular ligament. It's a very important ligament to keep the head of the radius in position. And then radial tuberosity, this radial tuberosity for the insertion of the biceps tendon. So the upper end of the radius, three features: head, neck, and radial tuberosity. Head articulates with the humerus to form elbow joint, articulates with the ulna, radial notch, to form superior radio ulnar joint. Neck is surrounded by the annular ligament and the radial tuberosity, this radial tuberosity for the insertion of the biceps tendon. This is the lower end of the radius. Okay, lower end of the radius. It has five surfaces. The five surfaces are: this is the anterior surface, which is smooth. This is the posterior surface, which is rough. And this posterior surface has dorsal tubercle. This dorsal tubercle is the landmark of the posterior surface. Then medial surface and the lateral surface. This is the medial surface. It's called the ulnar notch. This ulnar notch articulates with the head of the ulna to form inferior radio ulnar joint. Lateral surface, it projects downward to form the styloid process. And then inferior surface, this inferior surface articulates with the scaphoid and lunate to form the wrist joint. This is the area for scaphoid bone, and this is the area for lunate bone. Again, these are the two bones of the forearm. This is the radius, this is the ulna. This is the upper end of the radius, head, neck, radial tuberosity. This is the lower end of the radius, this is the styloid process, and this is the inferior surface. This is the anterior surface because it's smooth. This is the posterior surface of the radius, it has dorsal tubercle. Okay, this is the ulna, upper end, olecranon process, coronoid process, trochlear notch, and the radial notch. This is ulnar tuberosity, okay? Again, this is the radius, this is the ulna. Ulna, head of the ulna, styloid process of the ulna, head of the ulna, styloid process. This is the interosseous membrane connecting the radius with the ulna. This is the interosseous border of the radius. This is the interosseous border of the ulna. Regarding the skeleton of the hand, the skeleton of the hand is formed of three parts. The proximal part, this one, is the carpal bones. Carpal bones are eight, arranged in two rows. Each row contains four bones. One, two, three, four. Okay, and four bones. Then metacarpal bones are five. One for each finger. Then phalanges. Phalanges are 14. Each finger has three, except the thumb has only two. Regarding the carpal bones, these carpal bones, eight carpal bones. What is the name of the carpal bones? Remember, she looks too pretty. Try to catch her. So the proximal row, this is the proximal row. The proximal row is scaphoid, lunate, triquetral or triquetrum, and the basiform. So she scaphoid, lux lunate, two triquetrium or triquetral, and pretty basiform. Then the distal row, try to catch here, from lateral to medial, from lateral here, trapezium, trapezoid, capitate, and hamate. So we have eight bones: the proximal row, scaphoid, lunate, triquetrum, and basiform. The distal row, trapezium, trapezoid, capitate, and hamate. And thank you very much. Best wishes and good luck.